Episode 7, Arnulf et Pepin. When Clotel swept into power, he did appoint his own people to key posts, but he also relied on men who were already in power. Now, as stated before, the more the wars between the various Merovingian brothers and cousins went on for, the more they bled themselves dry financially and in terms of personal power and the respect of their people. Two of the men appointed by Clotel to power over Austrasie were two powerful noblemen, one by the name of Arnulf and the other Pepin. We'll start by examining the former and move on to the latter. Born in the year 582, Arnulf was likely well-educated. His family owned many estates near the Meuse and Moselle rivers. As a teenager, he was sent to serve Thibault, or more accurately, his uncle Gundulf, the Maire du Palais of Austrasie. Even at this early stage in his life and career, Arnulf was noted for his piety, a piety that made him wish to retire to lead an ascetic monastic life. Yet his family needed him to first confirm alliances and perpetuate the family ambitions, hence his marriage around 610. He would then go on to father two sons, Clodulf, and more importantly, Anse Giselle, who will play a more important role later. It is generally agreed among scholars, both past and modern, that it was Arnulf who played the key role in unseating Brunehaut. He led the court party against her, which is fairly impressive for a man barely into his 30s. Before we continue to the sole rule of Clotel, let us now turn to the other defining figure of his reign, Pepin de Landon. Pepin is an intriguing figure about whom we know precious little about. His origins are a mystery. What we do know is that his family was a wealthy noble line, with his father having possibly been named Calomon, and his mother remains a mystery. It is doubtful we will ever know more about his origins. His family had land centered around Brabant, Hesbaye, and the vicinity of Namur, in the lower Meuse basin. He married the sister of the future Bishop of Trier, an heiress of fabulous wealth who possessed lands near Metz and along the lower Meuse. Not that they're all that important. What is important is how, from the very beginning of his first appearance, he would show himself to be an adept politician. He was doubtlessly one of the leading figures in the movement against Brunehaut, and would help in toppling her. His treachery was soon rewarded in 615 when he was given the lucrative post of Maire du Palais over in Austrasie, with Pepin being firmly Clotel's man, just as Arnulf was. At some point in the 610s, he fathered Beg, his daughter, and around 615, Grimoald, whom we will see more of later. In 623, it was Pepin and Arnulf who were made advisors of Dagobert, their master's son, after they complained of his lack of presence in the east, which had become disastrously neglected and was in dire need of a figurehead to help enforce governmental authority there. This son, though, resented their presence, likely from the beginning. Quite what the two made of him cannot be fully known. Yet what is known is that upon his ascension to power, the two soon found themselves stripped of all power. Between the two, Dagobert preferred Arnulf, something that made no difference whilst Clotel was alive. His preferred advisor, though, was his own man. And so, when Arnulf tried to retire a short time before 629 from his post as co-maire du palais, he was refused by Clotel and had to wait for after his master had passed. The two palace mayors were rivals, though, with one likely preferred by the father and the other by the son. This likely caused some friction between Landon and the Bishop of Metz. However, they soon, around 629, did something completely unprecedented in the history of the Merovingian age. They compromised with one another. They did this by marrying Beg to Anse Giselle, Arnulf's son, with the father soon supposedly retiring to become a bishop, that of Metz, with his son being nominated the formal head of the family, while serving a political apprenticeship of sorts to Pepin, who would take over the unified political faction as the secular head of it. It was a great compromise, and a brilliant move, one that solidified unity amongst nobles of Austrasie. Sadly, while this alliance was likely supposed to help Pepin in his relations with Dagobert after Clotel passed, the younger king's hostility remained unabated. So hostile and intolerant of Landon was he, that when Arnulf opted to retire to a monastery, as he had long dreamt of, Dagobert threatened to butcher all his sons if he did so. This was a bluff, of course, as Dagobert could never have done such a thing, not if he wished to retain the support of the Austrasian nobility, support that soon became fairly shaky when a part of the eastern lands were chipped away at by invasions by further east, by the Wends. I do hope I'm pronouncing that right. Thus, with Nestri and Bourgogne firmly in his hands, with Austrasie rather shaky, Dagobert could do nothing to stop his favorite from retiring. He could, however, put a seeming end to the other noble's ambitions by taking him all but prisoner with him to the west and removing him from office under the pretext of keeping him with him as a personal counselor. Disgraced and never to truly reclaim his previous power, Pepin spent the next decade at Dagobert's court, likely a combination of hostage, prisoner, and counselor, but it would be a long decade for him. Landon would only reclaim office in 639 after Dagobert's death. returning to the post of Maire du Palais with the support of his previous faction. He would die a year later, though, in 640, with Arnulf following him into the grave on the 18th of July in either 640 or 641. After they passed, the leadership of their political faction would temporarily pass to Glimoad, who would lead it and the family of Pepin to unprecedented glory. Glory that would prove as short-lived as it was fatal for him and his line. But next time, we won't be discussing Pepin's son. For next time, we will discuss the greatest of the Merovingian kings and the last truly strong king of this period until the rise of Charles Martel, Dagobert Le Grand, or the Great.